Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Reinventing Creative Industries Research. Welcome to all of you here in the audience, and I'm very happy to know that there are quite a few people who traveled from abroad to be part of this here today. Maybe this is also a good moment to put your cell phones on silence mode. Great welcome also to those of you who've joined us on the live stream on the internet. And maybe this is also a good point in time to say thank you to all of those who have helped us on all sorts of social media to spread the word about this event, particularly thanks to the cross-innovation platform Birmingham, who are really, really great in doing that. My name is Sebastian Olmer. The hashtag for the event is CIRCA UFA. So, please don't turn off your cell phones, but go on tweeting. And Carl, go on playing with the educational iPhone games. As I said, my name is Sebastian Olmer. I'm a scholar in the field of the creative industries, and I'm also an organization hacker. And I do this organization hacking I've got a couple of companies. One of them is Serendipity Lab, and the motto of this company is hacking life into organizations. Now, what Jan Simons of the UFA and I have done over the course of the past 15 months is really hacking CIRCA, the Creative Industries Research Center, into the fairly traditional organization structures of the UFA, of the Faculty of the Humanities. And this is a challenge. It is also a challenge because what we were trying to do is to connect the world of rigorous academic research to the quite fast-paced and dynamic world of the creative industries. But it was also a challenge because what we really were trying to do was to reinvent creative industries research. Now, I'm aware that this is quite a mouthful, reinventing creative industries research. I mean, it's been going on for quite a while, but what we're talking about here is really academic research. So we're talking about serious, rigorous academic research. And the field of research concerned with the creative industries in academia has so far been dominated by approaches from urban geography, urban planning, and so on and so on. And I'm by no means saying that these kind of researches have not delivered an incredibly interesting amount of data and insights. I see Valerie Frissen coming in there. Do you want to take the seat in the first row here, Valerie? Yeah, thank you. A big hand. So, you all know sort of notorious notions such as the creative class and creative city and so on. Some of this stuff was very, very interesting. But in what we think is that it didn't go far enough because it oftentimes did not go into the processes, the innovative processes of value creation as they take place on the ground, in the creative companies themselves. So in a way, what they've done is produce data on effects of creative clusters, or have linked the presence of creative entrepreneurs to quantitative data about economic growth and so on and so on, and that's fine, that's great, that's important, we need that. But it oftentimes tended to stop at the door of creative companies, and that's what we were interested in, that's what we wanted. So the vision of creative industries research that Jan and I have implemented over the last 15 months at the UFA was really about that. It was about embedding rigorous academic research in the midst of innovative processes of value creation as they happen in the creative industries. And I can tell you one thing, it's great to be able to be at the big organization as the UFA and really sort of have almost carte blanche to sort of implement your vision. That was amazing. And also to work together with very talented, very bright, and fantastic researchers that you will experience here for yourself in a little bit. And it was also great to find you know, very interesting and just you know, fantastic partners to, you know, to be able to you know, who joined us in the quest, you know, in the quest for this sort of new kind of research in the creative industries. So, and it is in this sense that I think that the sort of the notion of reinventing creative industries research is really opposite, only in this sense. So, not hyperbole, but really that's what we meant. Why is this important? I mean, I think, you know, exploring the sort of concrete practices within the creative industries is important for, I mean, at least two things. I mean, on the one hand, it is important to understand the sort of evolution of our economies as, you know, as sort of the way in which new products and new services are developed and sort of evolve in the, you know, what you could probably call the laboratories of the creative industries, or, you know, of the creative sector within, you know, the sort of creative scene sometimes. But even, I mean, if we look at our current economic situation, and I mean, of course, we are in an economic crisis, I think it's even, could be even vital, you know, to look at, because some of the projects that we present here are not just about product and service development, but they're about, you know, new ways of dealing, of sort of dealing with the new sources, with these sources that have become so important of, you know, for our current, you know, economy, which is, of course, you know, human knowledge and creativity. I mean, they have become important, but they are also totally insufficiently understood. And I think that this is one of the main reasons why we are in the crisis that we are in. So, on the one hand, you know, product and service development. On the other hand, you know, what are these new processes that can really sort of appropriately deal with knowledge and creativity, these enormously important sources of you know, value creation today? So in this spirit, I should say, let's get on with it. What you will experience in the coming 2 hours or so are 6 presentations by our wonderful CIRCA researchers. Some of them have already finished their projects. Some of them are sort of in the sort of finishing phase of it. And some of them have finished, but the projects are still in progress. You'll learn to, you know, what that's supposed to mean. These presentations will be interrupted by short interventions by the Dean of the Faculty of the Humanities, Frank van Frey, and a short intervention by Caroline Gerold, who is the elder person of the city of Amsterdam for, among other things, economic affairs and art and culture. After that, we have a little panel discussion here, which should be quite interesting, you know, with our partners, because, you know, the people that you will see up here are, you know, each for themselves sort of legends of the Amsterdam, you know, creative scene. We've got a really packed program. That's also why I'm getting these signs, you know, finish already. So there won't be time for questions from the audience, but our researchers and partners have agreed to make themselves available, you know, in our reception after the show, and, you know, there will be space for questions, comments, and all sorts of serendipitous encounters. But now I would like to welcome to the stage my partner in crime and the man without whom none of this would have been possible. Please welcome Jan Simons, Professor of New Media and Program Director of the Creative Industries Research Program at the Faculty of the Humanities at the University of Amsterdam. Big hand for Jan.
And actually, I'm an associate professor. We have to be careful with these things in the Netherlands. Well, in the summer of 2011, the board of the Faculty of Humanities of the University of Amsterdam asked me to develop a research program into and of the creative industries. The then dean of the faculty, José van Dijk, wanted the faculty to be prepared for the so-called top domain policies of the Rutte I administration. Since the faculty didn't have much experience with the creative, or for that matter, any industries, we decided to conceive our assignment as a kind of a research project in itself. How do the creative industries actually look like? Who are the players in this field? How do they work? What sorts of products and services do they develop? And for us, most importantly, what are the research questions they want to deal with? And to the solution of which of these questions can the humanities deliver a contribution? The best way to answer these questions was, in our view, a very pragmatic and bottom-up approach. We adopted a very pragmatic and informal notion of the creative industries by considering any company or institution that worked in the fields loosely circumscribed by policy documents as creative industries, or who considered themselves, or who considered we as creative in one way or another as part of the creative industries. And we decided to submerge ourselves into the creative industries with so-called embedded researchers, who would work on the spot, inside, and in close collaboration with companies and institutions of the creative industries themselves, and develop a research-based contribution to a new service or product. And since the research projects had to accommodate the needs and the wishes of our partners, these projects needed to be short, certainly in comparison to the academic research projects that tend to take 4 years or so. We decided to design projects that would last for that would be doable in 6 to 9 months. That's more the rhythm of the creative industries themselves. The idea behind this embedded research project was not only to deliver cheap services to the creative industries, but also to learn from the creative industries. Let's not forget that we live in an era of a tremendous and rapid transformation of arts and culture, media and entertainment, architecture and design, and many other fields that are the traditional objects of studies of the humanities, and that many of these changes are being brought about by the creative industries. Therefore, we expect the embedded research approach to generate new research questions as well as new research methods and formats. And in a sense, it already has, since the embedded research concept has been adopted by NWO, the Dutch Foundation of Scientific Research, in its creative industries research call of last summer. The faculty approved the proposal, and I was allowed to appoint Sebastian Olmer as the coordinator of our program, and CIRCA was born. And today, we are proud to present the results of the first year and first round of embedded research. We were lucky to find 6 partners from the creative industries who were prepared to host an embedded researcher and who jointly covered a wide range of the creative industries, from the globally operating design firm Frog and the medium-sized media production company Submarine to the famous hotspot, the Volkskrantgebouw, and the unorganized organization, as they call themselves, the Amsterdam app of the Amsterdam app developers Amsterdam, to Virtual Platform, the former domain institute of e-culture, now part of the new institute in Rotterdam, and MediaMatic, a new media and arts institute that now can be best described as a very creative company. The first year has been an experiment for all parties involved. As I already mentioned, the faculty had no experience with the creative industries to speak of. The format of embedded research was completely new to us, to our partners, and of course to the embedded researchers themselves. What we asked for them was no small feat. They had to find their bearings in an environment that was largely unknown to them, and which, in most cases, wasn't very familiar with academic approaches either. Sometimes they had to develop and adapt their research questions on the way, while working in dynamic and sometimes dramatically and drastically changing environments. In a sense, they were acting like our canaries in the coal mines, and they've displayed great bravery and perseverance and came back with very impressive results, as you will see this afternoon. What we asked from our partners was no small feat either. We could not guarantee from the start that the research projects would yield a useful and deliverable, but we were very lucky to collaborate with partners who were very supportive of the idea of embedded research and who have all been willing to invest time, energy, and patience in supervising, guiding, and instructing our researchers. They really lived up to the reputation of creative workers of being flexible, inventive, and adaptive. If their investment in the research projects was largely in kind, it was also with great kindness. On the way, we have teamed up with a number of fellow travelers. Together with the Faculty of Humanities of the Vrije Universiteit and the domain Media, Communication and Information of the Hogeschool van Amsterdam and Waag Society, we build a consortium that will take the embedded research project further within the Amsterdam campus, a project of the Amsterdam Economic Board. With new partners in the creative industries, we have submitted a so-called strategic research project in the creative to NWO. Together with Favela Fabric and the Vrije Universiteit, we have submitted a new project to the Amsterdam Economic Board, and both these last projects built on the results of projects that will be presented this afternoon. We have learned many lessons in the previous year, which we want to share with you and everyone interested in this new way of doing research, and of course, the results of that research. Today, we present you the results of our researchers. That will be the lion's share of this afternoon. But later in the year, we hope to publish our first lessons learned in a book with the working title Reinventing Creative Industries Research. These lessons will certainly be brought to bear on our second round of embedded research, for which the Faculty of Humanities of the University of Amsterdam have given its approval. Today, however, our researchers will present their research results, and it is then up to our partners, our faculty, and the City of Amsterdam to let us know what they have gotten out of this experience. We hope that we will raise your interest in embedded research projects by the presentations of this afternoon. And if you are interested in doing research as an embedded researcher, with an embedded researcher, as a company or institution in the creative industries, or as a research institute, please don't hesitate to contact us, because we will open a call for a second round already next week. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jan Simons. And now let's get to the meat of it. Our first researcher is Boukje Knosse. Boukje holds a BA in religious studies. She also has a degree in art and research from the Rietveld Academy and a master's of research from the prestigious London Resortium in cultural studies. She also speaks in a ridiculous amount of languages and has worked as a journalist for, I think, all major Dutch newspapers and many art journals as well. Now, Boukje was embedded, Jan was talking about embedded research, so Boukje was embedded in the Volkskrantgebouw, which really, I think, is the icon, if there is one, of the creative industries or the creative scene, maybe more appropriately, in the Netherlands. And what she and we were really interested in is what's going on behind the facade, because we hear loads of talks and loads of statements about creative hubs and how great they are, and there's all this serendipity and so on happening in the inside. But I mean, are there in fact creative ecologies, creative ecosystems forming there, and how do they work? And that was exactly what Boukje was dealing with in her research. So please give a big hand to Boukje Knosse.
Hello, everyone. So I think that we can all sort of sum up the words that shape the discourse around the creative industries. Exchange of ideas, collaboration, innovation, synergy. Yet we sometimes don't quite realize what these things look like. So my task is to trace the empirical phenomena behind these buzzwords and to find out what's really happening. Since June of last year, I've been analyzing the creative ecosystems of perhaps the most iconic hub of the Dutch creative industries, the Volkskrant building in Amsterdam. For the past 6 years, this 8-story building, situated east of Amsterdam city center, right there, has been used by an average of 300 creative industry workers on a daily basis. It was set up by Urban Resort, and I've been working as an embedded researcher with them. Urban Resort is a non-profit organization initiated by members from the Amsterdam squatting movement. The Volkskrant building was the first among 7 temporary creative hubs that they run today. It's a so-called broedplaats, a term originating in a city policy aimed at protecting and enhancing Amsterdam's cultural climate by regenerating disused property for artists and creatives. My assignment was to identify the creative ecosystems of the building and analyze their workings. Now, this would provide Urban Resort with a better understanding of the different types of value that they help to create by setting these places up. And in the context of a creative hub, I defined a creative ecosystem as a group of people whose ties are both social and professional, and who recognize the value of their group for their output. So in other ways, the things they produce. Very much in line with their squatting heritage, Urban Resort aimed to create self-sufficient communities of tenants on each floor of the building when they set it up in 2007. Now, these groups would together have one rental contract, and they would constantly collaborate and would select new tenants whenever needed. However, many of these initial groups fell apart, and now Urban Resort wanted to understand the dynamics behind these processes. In order to complete this assignment, I conducted semi-structured interviews with over 70 creative industry workers in the building. I used participant observation and mapping methods to gain an insight of how the building is used by different types of workers and also what motivates them. And I found out that about 25% of the people I interviewed really valued the social bonds that they created within the building, so with their neighbors. And a focus group I ran with a number of Volkskrantgebouw tenants, of which this is some material proof, confirmed that a social atmosphere in which informal exchanges can happen and relationships of trust can be built over time are conditions for creative ecosystems to emerge. But it was only through a happy coincidence that I was fully able to determine what the creative ecosystems of the building really looked like. Because in 2011, the Volkskrant building was bought by entrepreneur Job Heijmans, who will turn the building into a so-called creative hotel aimed at an arts-minded audience. The building will have not only a hotel, but also a co-working space, meeting rooms, etc. And the back wing of the building will still be used as a broedplaats, so it will continue to offer temporary workspaces for creatives, just as the entire building does now. So, only 2 months into my project, Heijmans announced his wish to start construction works prior to the expiration date of most rental contracts. This meant that, in effect, all 185 legal tenants were asked whether they were willing to vacate earlier in exchange for a financial compensation. And eventually, half of the people working in the building would have to move out. Now, his company managed to achieve this by December 2012, and the processes of negotiation between the owner and the tenants provided a fantastic opportunity for me to observe who really valued the networks that they were part of. And I found out that each of these groups behaved differently, but a common denominator was that they were not only driven by a shared interest, but also by the fact that they were friends. So again, this combination of social and professional. And along the way, within this process, they articulated the values of their networks to their work, and hence claimed their existence as creative ecosystems. So, by using my insider's position, I could get regular updates from the tenants who were involved in these processes, and I could establish that the Volkskrantgebouw currently has 4 creative ecosystems. 2 of them have emerged sort of organically, and 2 originate in the groups that were set up by Urban Resort at the beginning. And the first one is a group of filmmakers from the 6th floor who met each other while working in other temporary creative hubs in the city. They rented studio spaces next to one another in the Volkskrant building, which made it easy for them to collaborate. Now, they insisted on negotiating as a group with the new owner. And as a result, they got better rental contracts and studio spaces in proximity of one another for the new broedplaats. Secondly, the core of the artists and creatives from the 4th floor has been there from the beginning stages of the Volkskrant building onwards. This ecosystem initially negotiated as a group, but finally only a part of this group managed to sign for a shared studio space so that they could preserve the atmosphere of collaboration that they valued so much. Then, a group of internet startups from the second floor met through various networks and collaborates intensively. They are currently looking to set up their own creative community elsewhere in the city, so they will migrate the value that they created within the building elsewhere. And finally, the creators and musicians from the fifth floor in the basement have been in the building since the beginning. And besides collaborating amongst one another, lots of them also DJ or design for Canvas, which is the club on the top floor of the building. And interestingly, it is actually the value of this ecosystem that got Job Heijmans interested in the building in the first place. They didn't so much act as a group throughout the process of negotiation, but in establishing an informal relationship with Heijmans very early on, the members of this ecosystem were able to explain their value for the overall creative atmosphere and hence secured their studios for the future after the construction works. So, in summary, there is a paradox to the workings of these creative ecosystems. It lies in the fact that it was only when they were threatened in their existence that they fully realized their existence. This teaches Urban Resort that although they can stimulate creative ecosystems, allowing for organic and unexpected growth is essential. It may also teach property developers that working with, instead of against, existing ecosystems will help to augment the value of these places. My research project is still ongoing, and the next step would be to find out if the loose and informal structures that define creative ecosystems work in their advantage when it comes to adapting to new circumstances. In other words, do creative ecosystems work because of or in spite of the dynamic context they exist in? I look forward to answering this question, especially because the answer could provide interesting indications for creative industry policies and practices. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Bauke. Now, this is exactly what I'm talking about. This is not some commonplace about synergies and serendipity, but this is really, you know, this is how it works. I mean, of course, it would be nicer if Bauke, you know, was able to go on for like 30 minutes and sort of explain the ins and outs, but we've got six presentations and partners, so, you know, we can't really do that. But thank you very much. Fantastic. I've got a question for Jaap. I mean, it's a, you know, Bauke describes a process that is quite, I mean, also for you, quite sort of disruptive and sort of unusual. Suddenly, you know, working together with this young entrepreneur backed by, you know, real estate capital and so on. I mean, in what sense did Bauke's research help you to sort of negotiate through this, you know, difficult process? I mean, very, very short answer.
Well, Urban Resort, I'm Jaap Draaisma, I'm the director of Urban Resort. We work with a lot of young people, researchers, people with a university background to run Urban Resort, to be open for our renters, for the creatives in our buildings. And Bauke was very happy to be part of that our own Urban Resort ecosystem, and we are with her. And so the cooperation was fine. And for us, it were two things. To make better the selection of new renters and the combination of people in our buildings, which is a good combination, not only for us, but mainly for the people themselves. And the conclusions of Bauke are very important for us for the selection and to regroup the people on floors or in buildings to have the maximum creativity. That was one thing. And the other thing was, of course, negotiation with the new owner. We want to continue the breeding place with the new owner, which is very new. Normally, you make a building extra value, and then some people with a lot of money come and they buy it, and you have to go. That's for artists, that's a terrible thing normally. And now we negotiate with the owner. He was aware of the creativity value we realized, and for him it was important to have cooperation. And so in the negotiations last year, one third of the building stays as this creative atmosphere, cheap laagdrempelig, easy to go for creative initiative starters. And in the whole process, Bauke, the research was very important. Well, like she showed in the presentation, to make the owner aware of this important thing. And now we have a contact with him that in the whole regeneration, in the new transformation, one third of the building stays as a breeding place, which is, well, which is new both for Amsterdam and for us. And that's, well, that was also her role, at least.
All right, thank you very much. We talk a bit more about this. I think I once used this notion of smart gentrification or something like that, right? But I mean, maybe we talk about this a little bit later on the roundtable discussion. Thank you very much, Jaap Dijsma. Our next researcher is Natalie Dixon, who holds a BA in journalism and an MA in media and culture. She's worked as a publishing editor in South Africa, where she is also from. And in Amsterdam, she's the director and co-founder of Affect Lab, a research studio measuring, investigating, and building experiments with digital expression of emotion. Now, Natalie has already left us. Natalie has, you know, sort of gone from CIRCA, you know, straight into one of the most innovative school that I think, you know, we have on this globe at the moment, which is London's Goldsmiths College. And there she is pursuing a PhD. Please give a big hand to Natalie Dixon. I should also say that, I'm sorry, she was embedded at Frog, you know, one of the, you know, most innovative and most important you know, global design companies, and she was hunting for Affect there, which is something that she already did in the Affect Lab. I'm sorry, I should have said that.
The year was 1969, and Hartmut Esslinger and his partners started a company called Frog. All lowercase, a nod to Bauhaus and the Federal Republic of Germany. It was a watershed year for technology. The first person in New York to use an ATM. Apollo 11 landed on the moon, and the Boeing 747 made its maiden voyage. It was the heady early days of Frog. They believed in emotional design, and Esslinger and his partners had a dewy-eyed vision. They wanted to improve people's lives. His often quoted mantra is, "Form follows emotion." Emotions are some of our most deeply private and personal experiences. They're very complex, too. They're cocooned in a cluster of our life stories, our DNA. Most times they're a complete mystery, even to ourselves. Yet, in emotion research, we hunt for affective charges. Running wild, these charges are let loose in our everyday encounters and our interactions. Do you feel fascination or amusement right now? Does your mobile phone intimidate you? Did you feel content and then rage when your coffee machine asked for a filter change this morning? The first explorers turned to the expression of emotion in man and animals. That's Darwin's work. And later, biometric measurements. That's kind of scary. A taxonomy of facial expressions in the 1970s. That's Ekman's work. These are amongst others. And then more recently, chartering the World Wide Web, looking for expressions of emotion between people and their online social networks. What this hunt for emotion gives us is an offer of the Holy Grail, to understand patterns, ultimately people's motivation and their behavior. In the context of design, emotional response can shape the design agenda of everything we use and own. In a research project that lasted 7 months, spanning the Amsterdam and Munich offices of Frog, we joined the hunt for affect. Frog is a global innovations company. They have offices in 13 countries, and their roots are firmly in design. They develop products we use every single day, so from a mobile application at a supermarket chain like Albert Heijn, to in-store touch screens, even to models for healthcare, mobile phones even. Working in a frog office is a lot like being Alice looking through a technological looking glass. Glimpses of future technology and new experiences are all around. The energy of the heady early days is still there. It's a very, very playful office, too. She's Italian. It's headed by a bunch of creatives who have a healthy curiosity for emotion. And as Frog experienced design director Laura Richardson emphasized with this quote, "I think our deepest insights are ones that have an emotional underpinning. When we say something speaks volumes to us, we're really saying it conveys feelings. I don't just love Slurpees. They remind me of a time my family was together. I got to anticipate getting it once a week after church. It was a ritual. I'm reminded of being a kid. It equals new nostalgia." So for Frog to innovate and generate emotionally responsive design, it's critical that they push their gender and emotion research. So as one of the unique affordances in this embedded research project, we were really able to set the agenda together in tandem, asking questions for myself as the embedded researcher and the Frog team, who had lots of questions too. We condensed it into a single mission. We wanted to develop a research method that gathers rich insights into the emotions of consumers globally and delivers a meaningful contribution to the design process. Frog research methods are expressly qualitative, with an industry reputation for exemplary work. They are experts in ethnographic methods, with design researchers based globally. Unmistakably, they see the value in research, but they have commercial goals too, and so they seek a very tangible benefit to the design process when it comes to research. And ultimately, this embedded research project was seen in the same light. The tacit Frog directive was that this embedded research project could not stray into the rarefied atmosphere of academic musings. It had to be wholly practical and generative. So with this in mind, and to generate an idea, we had an ideation session in the Munich office of Frog. So we had a group of frogs together, and then we're given unique scenarios. For example, how to measure an emotional charge during making coffee in the morning, or using a software package, or performing a mobile money transaction. These ideation sessions are called FrogThink. They're one of their keenest tools. They're designed using theories of lateral thinking, and teams of researchers and designers, and even clients sometimes get together and they have breakout ideas. They ask lots of fun, pacey questions. What ifs? What if we could trade in emotions? What if you could draw ATM, happiness from an ATM? And what if you could buy and trade? And what if people had no emotions? We came up with a single concept. After we'd divided up approaches, ideas, and themes, we distilled it into Emo Camera, a playful, social, and creative mobile camera tool that gathers knowledge of people's lived experiences and feelings in their own words and images. So practically, Emo Camera works like a real-time mobile diary. It draws inspiration from popular mobile apps like Instagram and values deliberately open space for interpretation. It calls for a turn to very playful user profiling. So imagine this. You're standing in front of a parking meter in Amsterdam. A rusty dial is part of the interface. After several unsuccessful attempts to register your correct time allotment, you throw your hands in the air in exasperation. It's not working. Take out your smartphone, you snap a picture, you stamp it with an angry face. You want to share it. You want to have your feelings validated. Emo Camera does this. Unlike any other social application, the aim is that it places core at the center of its content and function offering. All the user-generated images, all the graphics and the words are meant to record and elucidate your emotional experience. So where it can just be seen as another mobile version of a user diary, Emo Camera offers a very different departure point for Frog research. Its value and uniqueness lies in its use. If people were to use it to tell stories about their lived experiences, researchers could then start building emotion landscapes. So for now, Emo Camera remains a paper concept, but it highlights some important areas for research at Frog, for consideration like play in design research, the power of storytelling, co-creation of meaning with users, and the value of keeping spaces wide open for interpretation in emotion research. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Natalie. I would like to take one of the points you made and take him to Gerard Hoek, who is vice president of Frog. And what we hear from Natalie is that Frog is very much at home, in research, right? I mean, you do lots of research, and you got quite a reputation for this kind of qualitative research. So, I mean, what's the point of having an embedded researcher there in your company?
Wow. We definitely do a lot of research. We get the opportunity to think a little bit and really get some data before we get to design. I think a lot of other design companies are told to take the brief, next week come back with some concepts. So we have a lot of people who are academically schooled, who are very passionate about research, who want to understand what's happening with people, their behaviors, the realities of their lives. And they use that to generate ideas. And so there's an existing kind of academic interest in what's our toolkit like, right? What are the methods we have? And do those indeed efficiently yield results that we care about, that we find really unique and compelling and that are real, right? Like, we sell this stuff, for a reasonable amount of money, and these ideas need to be tangible, and the insights need to be very that they can be acted upon, right? And so the dialogue that we can have with academic researchers about our methods and how we can improve them, make them have, at least be real. Like, we can't just make stuff up, right? They have to be actually thought through and carefully done, and yet have this very practical and efficient aspect. So I think that's where we can really meet together.
All right, that sounds like almost an interesting model that we could learn from, or the university could.
Yeah, it totally goes both ways, right? Yeah. I'm sure that we'll talk about that a little bit more. But I totally agree with your opening that what we're trying to do here together is really impact the world and get better at what we do and have results that matter, right? And not just generate a bunch of paper that nobody will look at anymore.
Exactly. Thank you very much. And let's continue the discussion later on a little bit more. Yes. One of the things that I really liked about Natalie's presentation was this thing about Slurpees and the notion of that it sets you sort of sends you off on an emotional time travel or something like that, right? Back into the past. Because, it sounds a little bit like digitalizing Proust, doesn't it? With the Madeleine and the sort of the taste of it and so on. So, of course, this is a beautiful bridge to our next speaker, which is Frank van Vree, who is the dean of the Faculty of the Humanities at the UvA. And I think we sort of, the CIRCA and he started their career at the UvA very simultaneously. And so there is sort of a time bond there. But Frank is going to tell you a little bit more, why we believe that that makes a lot of sense to have this kind of research also in the context of the humanities and what the future of humanities creative industries research is going to look like at the UvA. Please welcome to the stage Frank van Vree.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to be here. This is an important event, presentation of projects that may be seen as the fruits of the faculty's efforts about 2 years ago. I'm happy to stand here and to have the people here from various sectors, universities, hogescholen, the city, companies, and NWO. And I would like to congratulate the organizers of this, of CIRCA, and particularly Jan Simons and Sebastian Omen, for their work that they have done the last 15 months. I got three questions from the organizers, which I'm readily willing to answer. And the first question I got was why is the Faculty of the Humanities interested in doing research into the creative industry? And I have to say that the first impulse came from the outside, particularly the developments from at a national level in 2010, when the government decided to start the program of Top Sector to stimulate cooperation between science and economy. The question why we are interested, we had to reply to these developments. And the former dean, as has already been mentioned, José van Dijk, she decided to install two new programs, what we call Speerpunten, Digital Humanities and Creative Industries. And an important element in this decision was that we would like to develop these programs in collaboration with the field, with companies, with the City of Amsterdam, and with NWO. It created opportunities, in sum, for new forms of knowledge, of research, and secondly, to innovate, to contribute to new forms of valorization. So for the first question, the second one I got was, what do you believe to be the unique contribution to the humanities bring to this new field of research? I think the humanities, as well as the social sciences, have to offer a lot to contribute to the creative industries. In, first of all, the form of content, a rich body of knowledge reaching from the arts to linguistics, and above all, analytical thinking in a variety of fields. And secondly, the humanities have also to offer something in the field of knowledge of media and technology. But on the other hand, we were quite aware that it may also be good for the faculty of the humanity itself. It may teach us how to create new forms of knowledge, of knowledge dissemination, technologically and economically. This brings me to the third question. What is the future of creative industries research going to look like at UvA Humanities, at the faculty? Jan Simons mentioned already, just this week we decided to spend more money the coming 2 years for projects in the field of creative industries and digital humanities in 2013 and 2014, a new series of projects. So that's quite a concrete example of what we plan to do and what we want to do. And we will continue to enhance our profile in this field, the UvA as the humanities faculty in the Netherlands, and to excel in this particular field. And we are currently reorganizing the research programs in our faculty and to make room, particularly also for digital humanities and creative industries as new fields of research. To conclude, we would like to invite private companies and researchers to join our efforts and particularly this CIRCA initiative. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Frank. Can I ask one more question? Is that all right? Thanks for answering the questions. But what I'm wondering is, it's one thing to invite, companies to, come in and support research. But I mean, it's another thing to sort of, make a step sort of out of the sort of organization structures that we know at universities and particularly at the UvA and sort of to connect. So, I mean, my question would be, what could you sort of also take away from the experience that Jan and I have sort of collected over the last 15 months? And how do you do this? And what I have in mind is exactly this, redesigning of the campus and so on that you've got, that's on your agenda at the moment.
Actually, we're also thinking of, with regard to the new campus of the humanities in the inner city of Amsterdam, we are thinking about, for example, also creating a digital lab, for example, for this kind of research. So we have to work it out. It costs a lot of money. But so that's one way to give this a fixed position into the university research. So that's maybe one of the answers.
Okay, I think I'll let you get away with that. Okay, well. Thank you very much, Frank. Thanks. Frank van Vrij, Dean of the Faculty of the Humanities. Our next researcher is Olga Paraskevopoulou. She holds a diploma in political science from the University of Thessaloniki. She is also an MA in political communication from Athens and an MA from the UFA in new media and culture. She is quite an expert on locative and social media, and she is also a true believer in networks. And she had to, because she, I mean, in a way, had almost sort of most difficult assignment as an embedded researcher of all of them, because she was embedded not in an institution, but in a sort of distributed network called Amsterdam. Super exciting, you know, making loads of noise in the city, doing great things, but not an institution. So Olga was not just a researcher, but she was also her own project manager and like a million other things as well. And she's going to present some of the exciting results of her research now. Olga, please welcome Olga Paraskevopoulou to the stage.
Thank you. Hello. So, yeah, I was embedded in Amsterdam for 11 months. And I got the opportunity to come closer with the people and practices that made that organization happen. And my question was, how can we identify new processes of value creation? How can we show those processes and measure their impact? To start with, I looked for bottom-up practices, networks of people that do things differently, that may inspire or provoke traditional thinking. So I took the Amsterdam organization as my case study and my source of data. App makers are passionate professionals. They create new technology and services. But most importantly, app makers provide an example of a new socioeconomic trend, one that is more decentralized and cooperative. A network model that is based on recognition and trust, not on control. We have seen examples of open source community-led development before, but with this study, I want to show how this is happening in the everyday life and practice. Due to the economic recession and austerity, innovation becomes an urgent call, a call to create more value than it's captured. And a lot of hope has been put in technology and bottom-up communities to get us out of the recession and crisis. However, there is little data about the software industry and the value it generates. This is why I decided to explore Amsterdam as a non-profit organization, a network, or community. I collected data and visualized my findings because I wanted to show it to a wider audience. Today, I'm not going to get into the process and the method, but I'm going to show you some things that I have found and some results. Meetup proved to be a valuable data source for my research. And it is a website that helps groups of people to plan events and meetings. And when members sign up to a group, they give a description about themselves, how they relate to that group, and why they find it interesting. So in the Meetup website, we can find many tech-related groups in Amsterdam. There are many people that want to attend interesting events and to connect to more people. But these individuals are dispersed. They are small units that do not form a unified base. They are developers, designers, or marketeers. They work on their own, in their companies, or startups. They may share the same passion for creating products and services, but not always the same vision or philosophy. By looking at this table, we can see different meetup groups and the difference in size and amount of events. And Amsterdam grows fast because it's open and inclusive. It counts more than 2,000 members today and has hosted 368 events in a year and a half. That is almost one event every other day. And this is important because the pace of innovation is faster when you live in a vibrant environment, when everyday life is like attending a conference. You meet new people, you get multiple points of view. You attend lectures, you observe, and you increase your knowledge. So Amsterdam has done a lot of work in these couple of years, bringing people, companies, and organizations together. And it's not just another meetup, it's just not just another organization, but it's a network of networks. It invites and connects all those different pieces together. Let's see how it looks like when we zoom in the individual level. This graph shows data from the meetup profile descriptions. Each node represents words they use to describe themselves. Lines between nodes show how often those words are found together. The blue color stands for development, green for business, and pink for design. What we can see is the diversity of the group, the different disciplines involved in the creation of software. But apart from the diversity in the group, I also wanted to see the amount of companies that are affiliated with Amsterdam. I extracted their names from the meetup profiles and asked the Chamber of Commerce to provide me with more data, like the number of employees and the registration date. It took about 4 months, but I finally got the data, and this is what it showed us. 74 out of the 340 companies have no registered employee. A fair amount, however, are BVs, and a possible explanation is that those companies are startups, so that they have not grown much yet. And another finding is that 63% of the companies are registered as of 2010. This shows how new and fast is the tech scene and why it's hard to keep up with its pace. This first data exploration brought us to the Innovis project. In collaboration with the design agency Clever Franke, we created two interactive web visualizations. It's a first attempt to show the micro level, the diversity and distribution. We do not present an edited story, but we are letting the user interact playfully with the data. This is a screenshot for the first visualization. It resembles the topic analysis I showed before, but this is an interactive version. The goal is to enable the user to explore different topics, see different backgrounds and interests of app makers. Here, the user selected the word developer, so we see a number of times that is mentioned and word that it relates to, for example, mobile, apps, and software. And the second visualization is a map that shows data about events, tweets, and companies. It shows growth over time as events multiply and spread across the city. More people attend and more companies get affiliated. The goal is to show the creation of a network around Amsterdam that connects people and allows ideas to circulate. Here we are in February 2013, so we can already see many companies plotted on the map with yellow, and with green are the two events that took place that day. But if we scroll back, and we can do that, there is a timeline, we would see that the first day of Amsterdam, the map is empty. So this visualization is for the app makers themselves to see their role and impact in the industry, what they can achieve when they find themselves and they get connected. It is a research instrument and a reference tool for policymakers. It will soon be available online. I would like to receive your feedback to feed more data sources and make more combinations to make more discoveries. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Olga, for this great presentation. Let's hope this app really materializes. Mike Lee, mayor of Amsterdam, I'm sorry, and the world's toughest programmer, as some say. What can you do with this stuff? I mean, is that helpful for Amsterdam?
We're talking about the creative industry, which implies two things. It implies creativity and it implies creation. Creativity is this wonderful, open everything, and creation is basically the termination of bullshit. So, you know, Amsterdam is in the business of selling the growth of an ecosystem, which is all bullshit without science, like everything.
So Olga helps you to make science out of bullshit. Is that basically the gist of it?
Before today, all I had was my personal feelings, but now I have science.
Thank you very much. That's fantastic. Thanks. Thanks very much, Mike. More of that a little bit later. Now, I would like to welcome to the stage Caroline Gerolds. She is the, and now I'm going to use the whole title, older person for economic affairs, art and culture, local media, participation, monuments, infrastructure and water, business, competition and purchasing. that's quite a title, isn't it? Caroline, your reaction to what's been going on so far, perhaps. Welcome to the stage, Caroline Gerolds.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I understood that I was announced as an intervention, and I thought, what can be the best intervention? Maybe to share my real concerns of the day with you. For example, 2 hours ago, the mayor of Rome called me because he was called by the Vatican to help with the election of the new pope. And I think maybe we can elect Boukje because she speaks her languages very well. But that was not a real question. The real question was, help us, because Amsterdam is a very creative city, with a new system for the elections of the new pope with social media. And he told me, when you finish it at 12 o'clock tonight, you will have the job. So maybe that's the best thing we can do now. Try to elect that new system. Or maybe I share the concern with you, which our mayor has, the mayor of Amsterdam. Because he called me 1 hour ago and he said it's not possible to do the crowning of the new king because we have some problems with crowd control. Unless you help me before 10 o'clock tomorrow in the morning with a new system, that we have that crowd control system and that we can have a new king. It's also not true. But I think it would be great if we can help each other to solve our real problems. And in Amsterdam, we always did that. We have a big history in that. Because when we wouldn't have done that, we wouldn't have been there. Because I always explained that the logo of Amsterdam, the three crosses, the St. Andrew's crosses, are because of our struggle against water. The second is our struggle against disease. The third is the struggle against fire. And when we didn't collaborate, we wouldn't have been here. So I think that's great that we're here together, that we can help each other to solve real and relevant problems. And I would love to give a big compliment to all the companies here. I see the logos there because our university, the University of Amsterdam, is very old. But I think the other logos are all very new. Not older than 20 years, I think. And I think it's possible when you cooperate that you use very dedicated knowledge that is there for centuries, but that you also use the new knowledge that's there from all over the world coming to Amsterdam. And why is Amsterdam so interested in you as creative people? I think we have a history in that, but it's also because we think that when we solve the problems here in Amsterdam, we can try to migrate our solutions to the rest of the world. We do so with water, we do so with waste and energy, we do so with food, we do so with health, and I think in all that fields we need your creativity, and then we can make better cities. And sometimes when I'm going abroad, people ask me, why is Amsterdam so good in solving that, I call it collective action problems. And then I say, that's because we made so many mistakes. For example, 400 years ago, we discovered Manhattan and then we sold it to the British. I think that was one of the biggest mistakes. And then also the British made big mistakes because they raised so many taxes that now the Americans hate tax raising. And I think that's really one part of the problem. But then you have no strong and powerful governments that can solve that collective action problems. And that's the reason why you need the Dutch to solve the problems, for example, with the water. Another thing is that I think Amsterdam is not only a history, but also a future, because we always focus on people. You see it in our art. For example, Johannes Vermeer, 400 years ago, it was really a breakthrough that he used the milkmaid as art. Ordinary people as art. Housekeepers, Rembrandt did the same. we focus on people. You see that the airport, our airport, Amsterdam Airport Schiphol, is so very good and has a lot of quality because we do not maximize the equipments. We have not one safety gate, we have the safety systems at a gate. It's more expensive, but then the people are getting more quality. Another example, we focus on people in our transport system. We have our people on the bicycles. And when you can help us to solve the bicycle parking problem, we would be very happy. But in our transport system, it's a focus on people, on bicycles, not a focus on cars or on parking lots or things like that. No, it's the focus on people. And I think that is very important. And for me, that's crucial when we say, I, Amsterdam. We have to focus on people. We together are the city of Amsterdam. And that gives us the spirit. I will conclude with my congratulations. I think it's very important that we have that embedded research project here. It exactly fits in the ambition of the city, to be a city of knowledge and innovation, to be a city of creativity and with a spirit of commerce. I think it's very good that you talked about embedded research in broedplaatsen. We put a lot of effort in that the last 20 years, and I have to go after this because I have to open a new broedplaats again. I think that's the 30th or so, but it's really very important. I'm happy that there are so many companies that are helping us to be a real connected city. There was someone from Frog speaking. Frog has a base in San Francisco, but also in Austin, in Boston, in Bangalore, Johannesburg, Kiev, Milan, München, New York, Seattle, Shanghai, Finitsai. It's in the Ukraine. I've never been there. Finitsai. Well, I think people are living in cities. Cities have to get more and more connected. Companies like Frog, Submarine, had to help us to connect this with other governments and knowledge institutions so that we can migrate the urban solutions. And last but not least, I think it's so important that we have a very good balance between public and private powers. And that's why we got a compliment from The Economist in November. They said Amsterdam is considered the leader of the pack. Instead of coming up with a master plan, it has put together what officials call a smart city platform, a combination of institutions and infrastructure that helps businesses, knowledge institutions, and citizens develop and test projects. And I think that's the most important thing. Together we have a balance of powers in which creativity can flourish. Thank you for that.
Thank you very much, Caroline Gerold. Can I ask you one more question before you have to run off to what is it, Beehive, I think, isn't it?
It's Beehive, yeah. On the Krukiersweg.
Okay. It's quite interesting. I like this almost of German Sendungsbewusstsein, you know, about the creative city of Amsterdam, sort of healing the ails of the rest of the world. I that's great. But you're of course, you know, the almost like, I mean, no disrespect, like a fish in the creative waters, right? I mean, in terms of, you know, creative city, creative industries. I mean, you're traveling a lot. You know, you're speaking at events all the time about this this theme. And you know, I suppose when it comes to Amsterdam's creative industries, you know a lot. But is there something that this kind of research, is there a dimension that this adds, you know, to your expertise, or could add, you know, to your expertise of you know, the creative industries?
The important thing is that it adds to the city, and that it adds to the country, and that it adds to the idea of connected cities and solving collective action problems that are important for our citizens. That's the most important thing. And when I see the presentations, I think it really adds. That's great.
Right. What we would have, thank you. What we would have really loved to do today is to present you with our, you know, publication, the working title, Reinventing Creative Industries Research. Unfortunately, I cannot do that because this is going to come out at Amsterdam University Press a bit later this year. However, Sanne, there, some of us, and I'm not going to say who, has recently written a book about a business model that addresses some of these questions that you were raising in a rather interesting and effective way. The book is called The Serendipity Machine, and this is your copy. Thank you very much.
Wow.
Thanks.
Thank you.
The Dutch are always used to unwrap it, but I will do it at home.
All right. So thank you. Think so. Yeah. All right. Thank you very much. All right. Our next speaker is Mark Stumpel. Mark Stumpel is a BA in interactive media and has also an MA in media and culture. There are lots of people leaving all of a sudden. It's probably because Caroline has finished her speech there. Don't be deterred by that. The great thing about Mark really is that he is an incredibly critical mind. And prior to coming to CIRCA and working with us, he's worked with one of the very, very few gurus that this country has to offer, which is Geert Loving. The challenge for him was really to apply his incredible knowledge about social media and digital tools, in a sort of practical situation at Submarine, in order to build more engaging media environments. And I think people were just going to get drinks, actually, so they're coming back. So they're coming back for you, Mark Stumpel. Please, welcome to the stage, Mark Stumpel.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. My name is Mark Stumpel. My embedded research took place at a mid-sized media production company in Amsterdam called Submarine. Submarine produces feature films, games, animation, documentaries, and has specialized in creating new forms of interactive storytelling, also referred often to as transmedia storytelling. Submarine has an extensive international network of creative directors and designers, and produces contemporary stories that take a critical, dynamic, and often playful look at modern-day society. What differentiates Submarine from traditional film studios is that the digital format makes it possible to improve a story even after its release. Normally, a film is released as a finished product, and for a creator, the sequel is the only way to respond to what the audience has to say about the film. Whereas digital productions are mutable, there's no end to possible improvements. The embedded research project, which lasted 8 months, was driven by Submarine's intention to learn more about its audience in order to optimize its storytelling. As every story consists of user experiences that are designed through possible user interactions, the focus of my research was generating insights into user behavior with the use of web analytics software such as Google Analytics. Although Submarine already utilized few of these tracking tools, the analysis of user behavior within the productions rarely went beyond counting visitors. Submarine called for the development of a measurement strategy using tracking tools to the fullest with the greater goal of stimulating audience engagement. At first, my approach was academic, documenting and examining the various tracking tools on paper. This shifted during the project towards a more pragmatic approach of researching them and how they could contribute to Submarine's work. As I learned by doing, hands-on, I augmented the use of tracking tools, and I also experimented with tools which were new to Submarine. For several productions, I revealed and interpreted user interactions which were formerly invisible or unconsidered, hinting to improvements from a user's perspective. I worked on 3 projects, the first being the Alzheimer experience.
The Alzheimer experience is a free online interactive story in which you get to know 2 people who have Alzheimer's disease, Ina and Gerard, and follow them over a period of 6 years. What we have tried to do is add interactivity, so you can switch between perspectives. For example, you can see Gerard, but also from the perspective of his wife Rose, and you can at any moment switch between the perspectives of Gerard and Rose. In this way, you can show how someone with Alzheimer's experiences the world around him and also how people living close to an Alzheimer's patient experience the world.
For the Alzheimer's experience, I conducted a research and development experiment in collaboration with the programmer at Submarine. And we used software to generate heat maps, which are graphical representations of user behavior, where different colors are used to indicate the level of clicking activity. The second project I worked on was the transmedia thriller Belliger Cell, which is a mobile application and is also a game that has an innovative second screen feature. That is, you can play the game inside the theaters whilst viewing the film. Through collaboration with the production team, I was able to collect and analyze data that was produced by players of the game inside the theaters. We could, for instance, see how many people used the cinema feature and until which missions most of the users played the game. What is important to say about the Alzheimer's experience is that the central theme is identity theft. And yeah, well, the users of the actual of the app, the players of the game, will actually also experience identity theft. So that's sort of a underlying goal there. The final project I worked on was Picnic with Cake, which is a cross-media adaptation of a children's picture book. The video website contains a player that plays several interactive animation episodes, which are also broadcasted on TV. Just like with the Alzheimer's experience, it's possible to switch between perspectives while viewing the story. So, which in this case actually means that the users can switch from perspectives while playing an episode. Through the use of weapon analytics software, I could, amongst other things, indicate which animals' perspectives were preferred over others. The deliverable of my research wasn't a tangible measurement strategy in the end, but I did write strategic recommendations. Moreover, the gathered insights didn't directly stimulate audience engagement. Rather, they brought about a mentality shift at Submarine that elevated the importance of audience behavior in the production and the design process. So the outcome of this research was a set of insightful processes rather than a turnkey research product. Through statistical analysis and the more elaborate use of various tracking tools, I could indicate how users reacted to certain design elements within the productions, while also pointing towards potential pitfalls in doing this kind of data analysis. For example, assuming that the collected data is always 100% complete and accurate, or that a flawed implementation of web analytics software can also produce misinterpretation of actual user behavior. The pragmatic approach of web analytics software, researching web analytics software, led to the use of new tools, audience insights, and recommendations for Submarine. For instance, make someone in the organization responsible for data analysis and documentation. Define clear measurement objectives in collaboration with the programmers. Go beyond Google Analytics and explore new tools. Follow how these tools develop over time. These recommendations might be useful in a follow-up research project. What I got out of this project as an embedded researcher was a great experience of being part of a dynamic media production environment, with the satisfaction of putting my analytical skills to use to introduce a new perspective to Submarine's operations. In doing so, I also improved my practical knowledge of web analytics software. Also, before this project, I was critically biased towards online tracking tools as a privacy advocate. Whereas in this project, I was able to make good use of them for a good purpose, resulting in a much more nuanced view of online tracking tools. It's all too easy to argue that they simply diminish our privacy because they track our individual actions online without our consent often. Tracking tools can actually help creators improve the user experiences and ultimately increase the value of a story for its audience. It was exciting and challenging to bring Submarine's audience to the surface. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark. Unfortunately, Submarine has been struck by a sort of flu epidemic, so none of them could be with us today. But actually, we're running terribly late, and there are like two more presentations that we have for you. So let's get on with it. And our next presenter is going to be Marieke Berkers. She is an architectural historian and a critical urbanist. She teaches at the Academy for Architecture, and she's also part of the City Forum, which I suppose is one of those institutions that make this form this platform that Caroline was talking about, that makes Amsterdam a smart city. She writes for and edits journals for architecture and planning, and her book Schiphol Megacity is coming out in 2013. She was embedded at MediaMatic, a very great institution within the sort of creative design field in Amsterdam. And she was looking for a real world application of the notion of organic growth that loads of these urban planning charlatans are losing these days. And she found something very, very interesting. So please welcome to the stage Marieke Berkers.
Thank you, Sebastian. Hello. I just found out the Pope said goodbye yesterday, and our Queen will say goodbye soon. So now even the God-given positions are changing. I think it's time to make space for new structures to keep our systems alive. For example, the structures of spatial development, and I'm going to talk about that. First, let me introduce the company I was embedded with, which is MediaMatic, a cultural institution that's exploring the interaction between technologies and cultural development. And they're doing so by organizing all kinds of events like exhibitions and workshops and debates. And after years of doing projects in the media technology, MediaMatic started focusing on biotechnology and urban agriculture and energy. And those projects with such themes, they take a lot of space. So MediaMatic puts her eye on the Van Genthalle at Oostenburger Eiland, at the edge of the Amsterdam city center. And they want to develop this place slowly. Now that was a great opportunity for me as an architectural historian to follow this case and see what was happening and try to get answers to questions like, what is the added value of creative industries in projects of spatial developments by a model of organic growth? And I think for MediaMatic, it was interesting to get what they were actually doing in a broader context of spatial development, what was going on. So I really jumped into the theme. I went to lectures and courses, and there were Twitter wars I was following. I read a lot of articles about this thing called organic growth. And I heard all the people involved, planners and housing corporations, the municipality, project developers, telling everybody, and at most themselves, we have to grow the city slow and get rid of fixed deadlines and detailed master plans. And after a while, I got really bored because nothing really much happened. So I decided to jump on my bike and to get to MediaMatic to see what they were up to. And I found out they were cooking soup. And there was this guy, Joanne, who had made meals in his diesel canteen, or actually what he was doing is making biodiesel and a soap out of discarded frying fat. And that was because Willem Veldhoven, the CEO of MediaMatic, had to solve some big problems because he had those monumental Van Genthalle, but the roofs were leaking. And his employees were asking him, how can I get hot and where is my food and where can I poop? So that's why Willem asked Joanne to make some food and energy and to get some soap. And then I got really interested and I decided to get all that theoretical crap behind me and start to look at this case from the perspective of an anthropologist. So I found out MediaMatic was developing the halls, but they kept really strict to their own core business, which is exploring new technologies in the interaction with cultural development. For instance, they did. There was a lot of research going on. Here you can see a chair with mycelium. Those are the roots of mushrooms around it, and they were trying to find out if this is a new material for architects and designers to build with. And also they built those great aquaponic systems. So they took organic growth really literally here. And they can make fish and vegetables for the visitors so they have something to eat. But more important, they're exploring all those new sustainable ways of agriculture, and they're having workshops so the people can learn how to make those systems at home themselves. MediaMatic was very busy, I think, with three things: with making communities, with experimenting, and with sharing stories. And by doing so, developing the Van Genthalle slowly. But what's important is that those elements are also conditions that are important to realize in spatial development by a model of organic growth in general. So for the owner of the Van Genthalle, who is also the owner of the entire 11-acre big Oostenburger Eiland, that's the housing corporation Stadgenoot, it's very important to also realize those conditions. But then to me it seems that MediaMatic is far better in realizing those conditions than a housing corporation. I mean, just let us be fair. If you have a choice of going to a party on a Saturday night that really rocks at MediaMatic with the MediaMatic community and learn about Oostenburger Eiland, that's far more interesting than go to a gathering with a housing corporation. So it seemed to me that actually MediaMatic shouldn't pay rent to Stadgenoot, but Stadgenoot should pay MediaMatic to continue what they're already doing. But that's quite hard because housing corporations and project developers are very much crammed in their old structures. And they think about new innovative models, but they keep very strict to old structures like responsibility, risk management, how to organize support for plans, and ownership and stuff like that. So in between, the Van Genthalle are slowly growing. And there's food for Oostenburger Eiland growing. There's the Van Genthalle get developed slowly. But also knowledge is growing, for instance, about new building techniques. And there's an amount of good stories growing in Oostenburger Eiland. And awareness that Oostenburger Eiland is a very interesting spot to go. And goodwill in the neighborhood as well. Here you can see one of the communities that's busy right now building a freezing favela, which I think is a very interesting project, because here MediaMatic kind of explores on micro level how organic growth is working. There's this crew of pioneering spirits who are building a small micro town in the Van Genthalle. And it's interesting to follow because it's not only about building small a small town with structures in it, but it's also finding out new structures, how to do that, how to cooperate, how to share knowledge, how to share system, make systems when you don't have much budget. I'm running, of course, out of time, so I can't say too much about this project, but you have to go and take a look over there. And I think there's, at the 26th of March, a symposium of the Fund of Creative Industries that takes place in the Van Gent Halle, and then you can also see this project, and it's about energetic cities, so that's a topic that's interesting as well. Now, to end, I'd like to share with you one principle that I got out of the organic growth research, and that's the principle that when you get cramped in your principles, you have to get rid of them, and then you have to make some really good hot soup, and afterwards you start making and experimenting and make perhaps some great falls, but then you start making the organic growth really growing, and you also start to keep a system alive. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Marieke. I'm going straight to Willem Veldhoven, who is the director of MediaMatic. So you're better, I mean, you put on better parties than a housing corporation, and you make good soup. I mean, that's quite something.
Better soup than housing corporations.
Yeah, as well, yeah. No, I mean, there is a serious point in that, right? So, I mean, it's not just about the sort of products and you know, the things that you build and so on, and the events that you put on. But there's also something inherently valuable about the sort of, yeah, the way in which you work, right? And I mean, I think Marieke is quite interesting that what she says, you know, they should pay you for what you're doing at the Van Gent Halle, right? Rather than you having to sort of constantly defend that, oh yeah, I'm here and I'm doing, you know, valuable things. So, but my question to you would be, I mean, in you know, this value question, you know, has Marieke's research somehow helped you also to understand, you know, this inherent value of, you know, what you're doing?
I think she's doing a fantastic sales pitch.
Right.
Can I get a video of it?
Oh, yeah, well, yeah, we're taping it. So.
Yeah, good. Actually, yeah, what is good about someone who's studying you is that they sort of summarize what the special qualities are of your process. And for us, I hope it will help us to convince Stadgenoot to actually start paying us. But the next researcher, get me one from the economy department or business development, that actually goes to Stadgenoot and and convinces them for us.
If they understand what you're doing.
No, that Marieke has done that. So the next one, I'm not criticizing her, it's essential to do this first step, but now I want the next embedded researcher that sells the whole thing to the owners of these buildings.
Yeah, I think Jan has to
subscribe to the next phase of your project.
Yeah, so Jan has to, you know, sort of extend his tentacles into the economics department, or maybe, you know, there's some sort of campus idea, you know, emerging here that, you know, to I mean, no, it's a very interesting idea.
We can't just limit it to one faculty, right?
It's not good enough for Willem. I mean, definitely. I mean,
that sort of compartmentalization will not work in society.
That's a very good comment. Thank you very much, Willem. And we see you on stage in a little bit. But there's one more very important presentation we have, which is coming from Sanne van der Beek. Sanne is has got a BA in psychology and an MA in media studies. She has quite a reputation as a blogger. I mean, she's got her own blog and she blogs here and there, but she also blogs for this very, very influential Dutch blog called Frank Watching. She has written a thesis on Deleuze's notion of the fold and has applied it to fashion, you know, which I thought, you know, is quite cool. And what she did at Virtual Platform is she combined all these sort of versatile skills that she's got in order to create a matrix with which one is able to, you know, assess some of this value that we just talked about with Willem. You know, that sort of, yeah, you know, helps you to assess and to, I mean, not measure, you know, because you can't really measure this stuff, which is why I was a bit reluctant about the economists, because they always measure. But, you know, you can show, you can sort of illustrate, and you can assess what the value of a creative project is. And this is what Sanne has, you know, beautifully done. She's developed a matrix for that. So, you know, your stage, show us the matrix. Sanne van der Beek.
Thank you, Sebastian. For the past 8 months, I was embedded at Virtual Platform, then the Sector Institute for E-Culture, now, together with Premsela and the NAE, part of the new Institute for Architecture, Design and E-Culture. Forgot my sheet, I think. Yeah. Well, as a sector institute, one of the main goals for Virtual Platform was communicating in a clear way what e-culture is. Because explaining that, well, that's no easy task. Because e-culture is multidisciplinary. Many sectors and disciplines come together, from architecture to healthcare, to the arts and to music, and from apps to transmedia or to augmented reality. Also, e-culture exists mainly in crossovers between those things, and due to rapid innovations in the field, is constantly changing. The E of e-culture is nowadays more about emergent technologies than about electronic ones, and culture is more about society at large than about the arts. So, in 2011, Virtual Platform created the Best Practice Database, an online database of more than 100 e-culture products and projects to communicate the complex matter of e-culture in a very visual way. But more so, more importantly maybe, the best practice serves as a quality mark. These are all examples of excellent e-culture products. So, how to assess the value of such dynamic and innovative products that go far beyond the domain of the traditional linear and static value chain and function more like a value ecology, which is multi-directional and always in movement? And this is actually one of the main questions at play in the creative industries. And what's so funny about this is although it's a big question mark for policymakers and researchers, people who work in the field on a daily basis with such dynamic processes, well, they know the answer in a very intuitive manner. You know, people at Virtual Platform, they knew and know what e-culture is and what not, and more so what excellent e-culture is. So the knowledge is there. It's just implicitly buried down deep into the experts of the field. So my assignment was to make this knowledge explicit by creating a toolkit to assess the value of best practice projects. Also, the toolkit needed to objectify, standardize, and legitimate the assessment process of Virtual Platform. Well, this created a very challenging position for me as an embedded researcher. On the one hand, I needed to be as deeply embedded as possible in the current assessment process of Virtual Platform to really get a grip on it and on the dynamic nature of e-culture as well. But on the other hand, I needed to keep a certain distance to really keep a broad overview and also see the flaws in the current assessment process. In short, I needed to be the outsider on the inside. Well, Virtual Platform had created a list of criteria, which you can see here. A list which was on the one hand not quite abstract enough to cover the whole dynamic nature of e-culture, and on the other hand not concrete enough to be very practical. So it came as no surprise to me that Virtual Platform didn't actually use this list in their assessment process. Instead, their assessment process was far more rich in depth and nuanced than the list. They discussed a wide range of elements, from quantitative and objective things, like, you know, what are the technological properties of a project, to subjective and qualitative things, like what is my experience as a user or as a viewer with this project. Also, they always took into account the historical, technological, and social context of a project. And lastly, they not only discuss the properties of a project, but also the possibilities of it. Like, you know, what are the possibilities for knowledge transfer? Or what amount of people can it reach? Or what possible positive changes can it bring to e-culture or society at large? So, taking this all in account, I created a toolkit. And first of all, to make the use of context more explicit and more objective, I created an application form which got us all kinds of information about the context. Also, I introduced theme meetings to compare projects within the same context to each other to get a deeper understanding of this context and be able to adopt a more critical eye. The second thing I introduced was determining how a project works in this context and defining this in so-called environments, which in turn determine which criteria are being used to evaluate. You can see here the three kinds of environments, and here you see the different set of criteria which are being used in the three kinds of environments. Because a project which is a form experiment, you know, needs to be judged on whole different criteria than a project which is applied to a small context or transforms society at large. I want to point out two more things. First, I made the toolkit as concrete as possible. You can see that standard weights and standard categories are being used to make the toolkit actually, you know, easy to use. Also, the assessment results in a grade. Well, this is not, to communicate externally, but serves as an internal reflection moment for the team. Is this really a best practice or not? Secondly, I try to keep the assessment process as open and dynamic as possible. You can tweak these standard weights, and also you can add or delete a criterion dependent on the specific nature of a project. In this way, the toolkit is able to grow with the innovations in the field and can also serve as a scout moment to spot new developments. Well, this toolkit is actually now up and running and used by Virtual Platform in their evaluation process. To conclude my presentation, I hope to have made clear that in dealing with such dynamic processes, be prepared to adopt a new perspective, which is evenly dynamic. Because as Proust already knew, the real voyage of discovery consists not in seeking new landscapes, but in having new eyes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sanne. Sorry. There is Proust again. Maybe I could, before I'm going to ask a question to class, I could ask our partners and Valerie to sort of start migrating towards the tables and the chairs there. Stools, rather. While you're doing this, I'll introduce you properly in 1 second, but just sort of to get rid of this awkward moment of transition. While we're doing this, let me ask Klaas. Wow, I mean, that's quite something, right? I mean, so you got this entire database of projects, and it's like hundreds of them, right?
120, roughly.
120. And is Sanne right? Has she really found a sort of not magical, but you know, tool that you can really use to assess the value? Because if she has, I think that's quite valuable for you, especially now that you've sort of merged with this bigger organization and so on. It could have quite an effect, no?
The last thing is certainly true. I think two things, as Sanne pointed that out as well, two things happened. One is indeed the having the outsider on the inside kind of made things explicit that were implicit before. So, but that would be kind of more knowledge articulation rather than knowledge development. But certainly we also developed knowledge. Particularly, I think, the form context transformation model, which comes from actually a rather old text of the Raad van Cultuur. Yeah. back then, and I think still in a lot of places, the idea that there is this logical chain from going from form experiment then to context research and then to large-scale transformation, whether economically or in any social impact, that there is actually a chain, I don't think it's true. And we actually found this out by applying these models to our database. And then we actually found out, or kind of made explicit and made provable, that these sets actually work as their own ecologies. And yes, there is a lot of transfer and there's a lot of connection. People move from set to set, but there's no such a thing as an idea or a product that moves from one place to the next. And so this is important. This helps us understand, apply those different criteria, understand what is actually why we think it's good, because in that sense she was very right. Like often you just if you spend a lot of time in a certain field, you know why something is good, yeah. You know that something is good, but you have a hard time explaining it why, especially to people who are from another perspective. Okay, having done all this helps us a lot in our current situation where we have to prove our salt to I don't know if that's a proper English expression. To the people of Premsla and NIE in developing a new larger set of criteria to do that. It makes us very kind of confident that we can come to a larger shared set of criteria.
All right, let's talk about this a little bit more. I'm seeing that I have to get you a chair because there's one missing, but I'll do that, no problem. There's one? Okay, fair enough. All right. So, this is an enormously impressive panel. I don't think they've ever been on a panel together, which is... I'll introduce them. We've got Willem Veldhoven, founder and director of MediaMatic. We got Tjeerd Hoek, vice president and creative of Frog. We got Jaap Dreisma here on the right. Mike Lee, director of Urban Resort. Mike Lee, founder and mayor of Amsterdam. Klaas Kautenbrauer, who is program manager at, now the new institute, previously Virtual Platform. And Valerie Frieseda. Hi, Valerie. We've already welcomed you in the beginning. She is the managing director of CLIC, the National Network for Knowledge and Innovation in the Creative Industries, and member of the Dutch government's top team, Creative Industries. Victor van der Gijs, who was supposed to be with us today, has to be in Hong Kong, so he can't be here. And I've already talked about the flu epidemic at Submarine. So thanks for joining us, and welcome to this panel. The first question that I would like to ask you, and maybe I start with Willem, we got already a bit of an idea, I suppose, but what was the idea, what was the motivation for you to accept a creative, not creative, but an embedded researcher into your company?
At first, very simple pragmatism. Some university guy is coming to you, says like, shall we pay the salary of a smart person to hang around in your organization for half a year? It's like, so the initial reflex is very simple, say yes, of course. Yeah. Then you say like, okay, now what?
All right, very interesting. Anyone, was that the difference?
Actually, and then we started lobbying for Marika because we were in this process of exploring the Van Genthallen real estate opportunity, and we're still in the middle of it. And we thought we need someone who has more experience thinking about these kind of contexts, because it's really not our field. And by now, we've learned a lot, but back then, it was really like, it's a whole new challenge for us, and we need help.
All right, you're paying a researcher helps. Was there maybe some other motivation
there's only a motivation, and there's no advantage in someone who's paid and doesn't do something meaningful for the organization.
Sure. No, I mean, absolutely. Yeah. That's a valid...
I'm trying to explain that at this moment of going in that direction, and it raises a lot of new questions. That's great to have someone who can methodically start off scanning that field for us and with us. Yeah, very helpful.
Right, Mike, what did you...
One of the central tenets of engineering is that you cannot fix what you cannot measure. And so if someone's willing to come in and measure something, then that enables us to actually do our job. Until that point, we're, it's just faith and good ideas.
So you think we measured something at Amsterdam?
It seemed like metrics to me. Metrics I
can work with. All right, interesting. So I know, yeah. I'm sorry.
I guess I'm probably a little bit more arrogant in a way. That I actually wanted to help you guys get better.
Why did you want to help us?
Well, so I'm a little like Mike. You know, I'm an engineer. I like to make things that actually matter and work. And all the research we do is really focused on getting results. And I do sometimes regret that I see a lot of, you know, incredibly talented, smart people work at universities generating knowledge that doesn't go anywhere ultimately. And that's where I think the mission that you had and that John had really resonated with what I personally care about and what I think would be very good for all of us.
I mean, I think that's a fascinating idea, and that's maybe also, you know, one of the big problems that universities and also the University of Amsterdam has today, right? I mean, because in many ways the organization structure just does not, you know, it's not really opposite anymore to at least not to the world that you guys work in.
That's right, and like we get this constant challenge, right? If it doesn't work, you know, then bye bye, right? Then it doesn't matter. If you can't make something out of it, ultimately generate real value that somebody also is willing to really pay for, then it's kind of a wasted effort. And I think that's a good, healthy pressure to put on smart people.
All right. So, I mean, okay, that's the sort of the, you know, fast, creative business sort of version of it, I suppose. What would be the, you know, ex-squatter turned, you know, developer as answer to this would be?
Yeah, with Urban Short, we developed these buildings for creative industry. But in the daily work, you have to keep these buildings running. You have to have people new. You have to get people out. You have to things to repair. So you have the daily pressure of running that company. And then the questions to deepening, to make it better, that in the daily work, that's hard because you have to pay. You have to get money back. You don't have enough room for making experience to do that kind of investigation. You want it. You need it. But the daily work is too hard. And then that's very good that some people from outside can look at your processes and help you by solving these problems because you have them. But in daily life, you don't have daily working of your company. You don't have enough space. You don't have enough money. You don't have enough time to focus on these questions. And then such a researcher can help you by doing that. And that's, well, that's another kind of view maybe, but it's the same of value generating in the normal process. You need someone from outside and with a little bit academic and making focus, you're making your questions a bit more strict on making your product or your company better. And I think that's on a commercial way, but also on a social way. Urban Short is not a commercial firm, but you have to run these buildings. And also we need making new, getting, well, developing it. Because if it's on the same level, it will be stopped. So you have to make it better. Yeah. That's important.
That's quite interesting. So in a way, you know, it helps you with the R&D, you know, where you haven't got the time or the resources for, you know, to play yourself. So I'm wondering, Klaas, you know, was that a little bit the situation with virtual platform as well? And I mean, if so, you know, what was it hard? I mean, because was it hard in the sense, you know, what Chert says, you know, he says that, you know, there's these academics and they write papers that nobody reads, and so, but that sounds like as though, you know, universities would sort of conserve a culture that's very difficult sort of to connect to sort of to more pragmatic approaches of companies. But was that something that you encountered in oh, well, that's a bit unfair, but in Sanne?
In Sanne.
Let me
make it a little bit more general or abstract.
Yes, right.
No, to answer your first question, actually, we were also interested in the model. We were really like, we would want to look also as embedded researchers on a secret mission to assess your quality, put it that way. To find out whether this kind of public-private situation would actually work, because it seemed to me like a very nice addition to this very top-down, in my perspective, the creative industry top sector meeting circuit, etc.
Right.
So that was interesting. I thought like the small scale, let's see how this really works, is interesting. And then, okay, having said that, I do think there was a bit of a kind of tension between the...
Exactly, that's what I meant.
Deliverables that Sanne had to offer you, the academic paper, and the kind of design that she had to do for us. And although they're both methodological, there's a very big kind of gap in between those two methods. And, well, from my perspective, I think it would be good to explore that for a next round, to see how you can find the research and design methods that combine those two.
Right, I think the friction is something that most of you, I suppose, also the researchers experience. So, I mean, we can explore this, Jan can, because I won't be at the UFA anymore, but Jan can explore this in the next round. But, let's explore this here a little bit, because in order to do so, we need your input. So, Willem, was there friction with Marieke in the project? What's the friction?
Yes, of course.
Tell us about the friction.
Without friction, there's no heat.
Aha, very good. In the Fagentale, you need heat.
When your fucking favela is freezing, you have to have friction. And it also helps you think and find new thoughts. So the friction is very, very productive. And we are looking for it.
Okay. That's great. But I mean, the thing is, there probably
How would you approach this? What do you want from me? Kind of discussion needs to happen at the beginning of any project.
Absolutely. No, I mean that's sort of what I was fishing for, because I suppose there might be a few people here, who are also from other university who plan to set up something like that, and they might be afraid of friction. But I mean, friction is just part of the process, isn't it? I mean, was there friction with in the Frog project at all?
No, actually, I don't think so. Right. But I think that's also because Natalie herself is practice oriented and fairly pragmatic. And on the other side of the fence, on our side, we have extremely academically interested people as well. Like,
right.
Because to be clear, we also actually, in all the work we do for our clients, generate a lot of, say, process and explanations and visualizations of information, not all of which is actually understood by the client or ultimately yields real impact. So everybody's always trying to find out, right? Like, what's the exact right amount of work you can do to get to the right results and to get the client what they really needed and to build solutions that really work.
So it was a fairly smooth sort of sailing.
I think so.
All right, let me ask Natalie though,
because exactly.
she was the researcher. Did you, was there some sort of hiatus, or did you feel like a friction between the more academic work that you had to do on the CIRCA and the sort of more entrepreneurial work you were doing for Frog?
No, I enjoy Frog's very industrious and entrepreneurial spirit, and I think I mentioned this actually, just echo Sherrod's thoughts that everyone at Frog has a very strong academic leaning. They're really interested in research, so you never hit a blank wall or a glaze over. People were really interested to talk to you, and they had really deep insights. So I think it was a nice match. It landed up being pragmatic and academic at the same time, so just kind of a marriage. It was good.
All right. So Jan.
Yeah, I think there were a couple of other sorts of frictions involved. I talked to Elizabeth Rush of Frog this week about Natalie's project, and she, for instance, said that it would have been helpful if she could have combined Natalie's research with a designer and a programmer to really come up with an eco or a camera or a prototype of it so you could experiment and play with it. And that's the thing I think we should consider for the next round. What kind of expertise do you need for a project and to develop a project into a really useful deliverable?
Yeah.
Now we have done some preliminary work for interesting tools, toolkits, etc. But I think we should think a bit more about how to set up a useful program that can develop a real deliverable within a period of 9 to 12 months.
Yeah, I think Natalie alluded to that also by saying, like, this is an idea on paper, right? And ideas on paper in the creative industry tend to not really impress many people. We have a lot of those usually. So making it, really building it, and then trying it out and seeing if it works is a very important part of making things really have teeth. It is, however, more of an expensive investment, right? So you got to figure out how to really do that.
All right.
Might mean a collaboration with other faculties also.
Yeah, yeah, I like this idea, and I'll definitely come back to that. I mean, because I think that's very, very important. But at this point, I would like to bring in Valerie, who happens to be the only woman on our podium at the moment, which is a shame. I mean, you know, hearing this, you know, hearing these, you know, remarks on, you know, friction and that it's, you know, how to overcome it and so on and so on. I mean, is there anything that you know, you can take away from that for, you know, sort of on the sort of policy dimension?
Well, not on the policy dimension, but on the actual work that we're trying to set up, that is bringing together the knowledge world and the creatives. I think this is a predecessor of what we are aiming at, to build up at CLIC, at the national level. And so I think what it is really exciting what I've heard here. It works best, I think, if both worlds take something out of it. I'm not always sure when I heard about the project how it was set up in that sense. For instance, I was trained as an anthropologist myself, and that makes it exciting for me, this concept of embedded research, because anthropology is embedded research par excellence, I think. But one of the questions that came up during the presentations was what actually were the mutual expectations of each other? Sometimes it sounds a bit like it's a sort of the company or the organizations in which you're embedded is the research environment in which you are doing your research. That can be one kind of relationship. Or are you actually doing something that was based on a question raised by the organization? It can be very different kind of relationships between the partners in this field. It's not always very clear to me, but they're short presentations. But I'm most excited about the kind of results described where these two worlds meet and something happens in that meeting space that maybe the expectations and the friction or the expectations can be very different, and that may result in some friction. But I think the whole idea about ClickNL is not so much to create a sort of environment for valorization or vraagsturing, or I don't know what the English word for that. Both horrible words, I think, because it's a very linear way of looking at how knowledge and creativity may profit from each other. But you need to create an ecosystem or a space where these two worlds can meet. And this is a good example of it. And maybe it's not completely developed yet, but you need these kind of projects to build on those experiences.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think there is indeed a very pragmatic you know, dimension to our approach, and there has been. And I think that's one of the strength. I mean, if we, you know, would have approached it in very strict academic terms, and okay, this is the research question, this is the method, and so on and so on and so on. I mean, part of this, of course, is part of, you know, is essential to academic rigor. I mean, absolutely, I totally agree. Yeah. But as again, Deleuze said, you know, the unexact yet rigorous, you know, is the way to go about it. So there will always have to be a certain amount of openness, and you know, you cannot impose, you know, your idea of academic structure.
But also the other way around. I mean, I think it's most interesting if the organizations pick something out. For instance, the need for reflection on what you're doing on a daily basis. Yeah. If you have to act swiftly because you're constantly producing results, which companies often have to do, that's part of their business. Right. You sometimes forget that if you step back a little, that you can build up knowledge and build up on the experiences and all the innovation process that you're in the middle in.
Sure, thanks.
And I think that can help too.
Okay, let's. That's very interesting because
May add one thing to
that. Can I ask a question to Jaap?
Just
one second.
Embedded research element. It would be
We'll come back to that.
Most interesting, Valerie. If it could also be the other way.
You cannot
push
it up. No, you can't. Okay, thank you. But one of the things that was really characteristic for these 6 months of research was that was that all these projects shifted. So it was not just in the beginning that we had some sort of moment of openness and sort of open resource questions, but that then sort of shaped in the first weeks and months of the project. It was also that the projects changed dramatically. And I mean, one of the maybe most radical changes was at the Volkskantgebouw, when this transformation thing happened. So the entire project sort of didn't go off rail, but had to be reoriented. So with a sort of strict research program, the project would have been over. And so how important was this sort of malleability, this flexibility of the research in your project?
For us, it's pretty sure the research questions were more pragmatic, of course. So the academic side of changing from perspective from the researcher was for us not important. That was important maybe for Bauke and for the university. For us, the initial question was how to deliver better creative infrastructure, better creative ecosystem. We are creating that in our building. How can we make it better? With the changing of ownership and the transition of the building from a art factory to a combination of hotel and art factory, which is completely different. The question of to look at the essence of the creative ecostructure was more important and was more urgent because we had to negotiate with the owner and to use the results and our ideas to negotiate with the owner to continue it in a completely other way. So maybe from the side of research, it was a very change, but for us, to have more sharp the essence and the features of the creative ecosystem, well, it just continued and the urgency was bigger, and so it was finer to have Bauke in our middle.
So that's an argument, I think, for a great deal of flexibility. Now, I mean, talking about flexibility and organizational change, there is no organization to change. There's only change, I suppose, right? And you could say that in Amsterdam.
It was a particularly interesting period because, that first year, it was very much, me and the original people, right? And then it was like, wow, holy crap, it's really hard to do this stuff, and we're not going to be able to do it ourselves. We need other people to take up a mantle. Like, there was that inevitable passing of things on to the next generation. And there's no proof when the founders pass on the mantle of the org that the org will continue to exist, let alone, grow or get better.
So if you look at, say, Amsterdam, in a year's time, what do you think it's going to look like, and how will Olga's project, would it have some influence on in the future of Amsterdam?
I mean, I really think so, because at the end of the day, people are going to continue to come to the city, they're going to continue to be inspired, they're going to continue to, want to participate and pick up the mantle so that, when the previous generation, now looking so old after a year, is ready to lay down, there's somebody to pick up the reins. I mean, Amsterdam is a movement that will continue to exist as long as people continue to show up and believe in Amsterdam. And the minute that nobody needs Amsterdam, then Amsterdam will cease to be.
Right. Okay. And we've helped to Olga has helped to turn this bullshit into something to
exactly.
believe in.
Yeah, exactly. There's numbers, so I can look at my peers and say, Yeah, this thing I was been telling you about for 2 years, like, that's an actual thing. Here's a map.
Okay. So, I mean, one of the things that happen also, in these project is failure or something going terribly wrong. And one of the things that happened in actually Bauke's project is that, we started with two partners. We started with a combination of partners. I mean, on the one hand, Amsterdam, we wanted to embed her in the Amsterdam incubator, but at the same time also really wanted her to be part of it. So, we partnered up with a company called Flight Lead, which is a gaming company, and this gaming company sort of halfway through the project, this whole thing went wrong, or not wrong, but it didn't work out. And how was that for you, Bauke? Was that a big thing? I mean, was that something that almost put the project off rails, or what did you do?
Okay, well, I can say something about that. First of all, failure, interesting choice of word. I didn't quite perceive it that way, but basically what happened was that I started out my project with two partner institutions, one being Urban Resort and the other one being Flight Lead. And Flight Lead basically functioned as a working environment and was also hopefully going to offer me their tools in creating new ways to assess the creative ecosystems of the Volkskanzkabau. So Flight Lead is a gamification company, which is a bit different from a gaming company, and their expertise is in creating online communities. So my idea was to use that expertise to come up with, say, an online platform or another product that would help the communities of creative hubs, such as the Volkskanzkabau, interact. And then two things happened. One is that the project on which I would gain the experience with community building didn't come off, and this was within the context of Flight Lead. And then second, the transition within the Volkskanzkabau was very much happening. So as I wanted to bring the creative ecosystems together, I almost saw them being, you know, threatened in front of my eyes. So I then adopted a very much more ethnographic methodology rather than using the context and the expertise of Flight Leads. So it was more a sort of change than failure.
Could I offer some words here?
So,
words from above.
Words from above? Let me comment on that, because my point was exactly that. It's not a failure. It is something that just happens in this world, and that one has to accept also, you know, if one sets up these kind of projects. Now the words from above.
It is not a question of whether we will fail. We will fail. Failure is death, and death is inevitable. It is only a question of whether we fail forward.
We fail what?
Forward.
We fail forward, exactly.
As long as we fail forward.
Is that something that you use for the sort of reintegration of virtual platform as well? Sort
failing
of failing forward, yeah.
We might. It's too early to say in which direction we are failing.
Yeah. All right. And
it's exactly. It's a Popperian kind of.
Say again.
Popper, for
Well, never mind. Oh, Popper. Yeah. Oh, Popper. All right. Very good. All right. So let me come back to this big question that sort of popped up already, like for a few times, and that is the question of maybe even a new model of research, a new sort of form of organization for research. I mean, you know, chaired. You know, you are doing research. I mean, not academic research, but very applied research. And you're dealing with tons of academic institutions, you know, all the time. So, I mean, is there a model that you've got? Is there a model that you know, Valerie could learn something from? Can you describe, you know, how this is working?
Well, well, I think the setup you've got here can work, but there definitely are some conditions that you have to learn from these experiences. That will lead to success or to failure, especially if you're talking about something like the creative industry, where everything is so fluid. You have to create a little bit of a beachhead of calm and an understanding of what the objectives are for this to succeed. You have to also have some internal champions, right, with the hosting company, who really believe in this and who can actually have the create the time to have the interaction. So there are a number of conditions to make this sort of a thing work for both parties. Sometimes you have to maybe even look very specifically, like if you want somebody to succeed in these kind of extremely fragmented, fluid conditions, you need somebody who can deal with that kind of level of ambiguity and comes in with an understanding that that's how it's going to be, right? That they're not going to land at some like governmental office where there's a, you know, complete calm and yeah, you got 6 months to do whatever it is you want to do. No, that it's going to take a tremendous amount of energy and passion. Now, with regard to like, does this lead to new methods or, you know, deliver on the extremely ambitious title of today? I don't know. I do think that certainly in the creative industries, companies that get to do this sort of research are always trying to make it better. So all the methods are constantly evolving. We use new technologies. We use new types of data that get unlocked. There's also a number of methodologies we've been using for probably two decades at least that are still very valuable, and we're mostly sort of tweaking them to get more efficient and cost effective with them. So we can learn from those, but it's hard for me to say like, oh yeah, you know, this particular method is going to really allow us to have a model in which we will, you know, generate new types of research.
No, but fair enough. I mean, a class.
Can I comment on that? Yeah. It seemed a bit following on what you said, but also on our, let's say, very positive and non-failing experiences. It seems to me that the one success factor, one condition, is that you kind of are at least have a mutual understanding of the mutual value systems that go behind. So it's not a question of
right.
method,
mm-hmm.
I think. Method is one step next. It's okay. The thing that comes before that. It's understanding that a company or a organization like ours, we're not a company, has certain goals and to respect those goals. And then the other way, that the academic situation also has certain goals and respect those goals. And once you're clear on that, then you have a way forward. And if you're not clear on that, then you have these tensions that are not so productive. And this not only goes for these kinds of systems, but actually with these kinds of setups for all kinds of places like social design or artists that work in companies or a lot of places where situations where different disciplines try to come up with a fruitful combination. This is exactly where it goes wrong, is that they don't respect each other's value systems. So you don't have a way forward. And it seems a good idea to have this interdisciplinary collaborations, but then you end up discussing very large conditions instead of going where you want to go.
Exactly. So, I mean, this is very interesting in the context of Willem's suggestion of this sort of interdisciplinary campus catering for the needs of MediaMatic. And, you know, would that be sort of, could you integrate that idea? I mean, the problem or the sort of problem of translation, I suppose, is it, isn't it?
That idea is the basis of any cross-disciplinary collaboration.
Right.
So, yeah.
The difficulty is usually that the system in which you have to operate is organized in a disciplinary way. So, for instance, if you look at science, actually what you're doing is great, but would be even better if it would be multidisciplinary and it would not distinguish between the humanities and the social sciences. And that's what we're trying to do, I think, but that takes some time before those pillars are broken down. Yeah. But if one thing is important for the creative industries, is this multidisciplinary approach, I think. And we'll still have to do a lot of work there to profit from that the most.
Yeah, I mean, but I mean, you know, what stands in the way of this is, of course, the way the university is organized nowadays, and also the way the money flows are organized. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, we can all say
that's
that
what
we need interdisciplinary and then transdisciplinary, you know, structures. But as long as I'm not allowed to even talk to someone who's outside the faculty of the humanities, because you know they're not, you know, part of this.
And also,
I mean, that's exactly the reason why our universities are not anymore these places where great ideas are coming from, but some sort of TEDx nonsense.
It's also the idea that academic work is primarily valued on the basis of publications.
Yeah, as well.
If the value system in the academic world would be open to societal relevance or to design results or whatever, it's also something we try to push on, but those are traditions and institutional frameworks that are not easy to
of course no they are dinosaurs and they have to move slowly. I mean, they have to be slowly. Mike.
If I may, though, I think that at the end of the day, you want to talk about making this stuff better, take it from me, not a single one of these research projects needed an app. Right, you need basic presentational skills to make everyday people see the meaning and value of what you're doing, and that not only makes your research fundamentally better, it makes your students fundamentally better, and it also will drive external pressure on the university.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. I think the audience is making it very clear to us at this point that it's time to close this discussion. And I would really like to thank you for your presence here. And all of you are also going to get not our CIRCA book, which is going to come out later, but one of those. Thank you very much to all of you. Thank you. Thank you very much for being here, and I hope you could take something away from this reinventing the creative industries research. I hope I'll see you all back here probably for our book launch. And we've got now drinks in the foyer, a little reception, and you'll have the chance to talk to our researchers and partners and ask questions and comment. I've seen quite a few interesting comments on Twitter and so on. So feel free to talk to them. Thank you very much. Thanks to all the researchers. You gave us some wonderful presentations. And thanks to all the partners for being here and making this what I a very, very interesting event for me. Thank you very much. Thanks.